Soleimani in Iran, COVID spreading in Wuhan, flooding in Jakarta while Australia starts to burn. Kobe Bryant, World War III, Billie Eilish, Grammy sweep, Trump's acquitted, plane is shot down, okay, boomer girl. Carolina, Tunisia, Kabul, Delhi, Iowa, J-Lo, Pete and Pay to Play, Pop Smoke, Sonic, Birds of Prey, Super Tuesday, Biden's in, Tom and Rita, positive, quarantine, no NBA, Breonna Taylor, say her name.
Start the fire, it was all we burned, since the world's been burning.
Travel bans and TP rolls, islands filled with animals, anti-maskers, Tiger King, cure yourself with chloroquine, Boris, Fauci, Bernie drops, no Olympic scuba flops, coffin dancers, UFOs, nature's healing, not Dow Jones, Quibi, Elon, Leafy's back, Nova Scotia, Anon hack, murder hornets, Corbin drops, Amy Cooper calls the cops, Little Richard Diaz wins, Poland crackdown, fighting stands, Kim Jong-un, is he dead? I can't breathe is what he said.
Start the fire. Was always burning since the world's been turning. We didn't start the fire. No, we didn't fight it, but we tried to fight it.
BLM, curfew time, statues falling, fists will rise, people marching in the street, fire burning, take a knee, unmarked vans and violent cops, gas them for a photo op, JK Rowling, Lady A, everything is now a cake. Epstein Island, Smasher grieves, hold the chat for a few weeks, Kane and Lewis, Kanye runs, Bolsonaro, Jen is done, Dawson, Ben Shapiro, Wop, Alexi poisoned, Megan shot, Mark and Pat at RNC, Panthers dead at 43.
We didn't start the fire, it was always burning since the world's been turning. We didn't start the fire, no we didn't hide it, but we tried to fight it.
Leafy's gone, Lebanon, Mulan, Mali, Kamala, Robert Trump and Jacob Blake, virus claims 200k, Proud Boys, Kyle, NFL, Among Us, Fall Guys, Travis, Meal, BTS on top with joy, wildfire cause it's a boy, Tenet bomb, sky is red, TikTok banned and Eddie's dead, vote by mail, not too late, Ginsburg's at the pearly gates.
We didn't start the fire, it was always burning, since the world's been turning. We didn't start the fire, we didn't fight it, but we tried to fight it.
Amazon, QAnon, Steve's in Smash and Twitter's gone. Trump's contagious, back away, Coney Barrett's here to stay. Togoland, Bond is dead, there's a fly on Pence's head. Eek'em boke'em, how it's going, when you're clean then you will know it. Line of contact map turns red, then the blue votes surge ahead. Trump calls foul, stop the count, Biden wins by small amount. Portland deepfakes Rick King Vaughn, Etta comes, Trebek is gone. Unison is console wars, what's this world heading for?
Hey guys, Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond Dag Studios here, and holy shit, it's finally over.
Fuck you, and you, and you.
Okay, I know that 2020 isn't technically over yet. We've still got one more month to get through, and if the rest of the year has been any indication, December will finally see the resolution of the Murder Hornet subplot, but I'm just so thrilled that the finish line is in sight. And to be clear, 2021 isn't exactly looking like it's gonna be a huge improvement, but at the very least it won't be able to crush our souls anymore, since 2020 has already crushed everyone's collective spirits to the approximate density of a neutron star. The state of the world has basically just turned us all into Simpsons fans at this point. We may desperately yearn for the old days to come back, and we may be horrified by what's happening, wondering where it all went wrong, and just wanting it all to end, but deep down, we know that the end is nowhere in sight, and expecting things to meaningfully improve is just a waste of energy that's only setting you up to get hurt. But of course, that's the world on whole, and that's not what you clicked on this video to hear me talk about, so what about 2020 as a year of popular music? After all, haven't I been saying all year that popular music has been the one silver lining to this year-long chapter from the Book of Revelations? I mean, I've been putting out video after video, season after season, tracking the trends in pop music over this singularly unique period of history, and those charts have gotten some of the best scores I've ever given, right? In fact, wasn't it just a couple months ago that I said the American people have finally gotten good at choosing what music to make popular, and that I expect this upswing to continue for a good long while? I said that, right? And I still believe that, right? Sure.
Don't stay away for too long.
Look, on the whole, 2020 was not a bad year for popular music. In many ways, it was actually quite good. Most of the biggest hits of the year are pretty high quality, they held up well to overplay, and the 2020 Hit Parade was a pretty diverse tapestry in which you're practically guaranteed to find at least a good few songs that appeal to you. That being said, though, my job is to analyze popular music, you know, the music that more people cared about than anything else. But I gotta be honest, I've been running this channel for more than 3 years now, and over all that time, I don't think I've ever seen a bigger disconnect between the music topping the charts and the music people actually cared about than I did in 2020.
Talk to me.
I mean, part of the reason for that is obvious. After all, this was the year that society curled up into a fetal position and sucked its thumb for 6 months straight. And not only was music not exactly the first thing on everybody's mind, but quite simply, the environment for songs to become huge, memorable hits just didn't exist this year. I mean, compare 2020 to last year, where it seemed like the American public seized the means of production when it came to popular music, and the biggest music of the year was all stuff that people genuinely loved and cared about. If you think back a decade and a half to 2019, you'll remember that the biggest songs of the year included an in-your-face trap-flavored empowerment anthem that came out 2 years earlier, a teenager casually bragging about fucking your dad, and, of course, the legendary team-up between the achy breaky heart dude and the guy who made an anti-stan anthem themed around Chowder. None of these were songs that the industry wanted to get big. They became hits entirely because the American people came together and decided that this was what we wanted music to be. And you'd think that with the entire world on lockdown and everybody stuck on their phones, pop music would become more of a unifying factor than ever before. However, in 2020, everyone's day-to-day experiences became so miserable, so unfocused, and so isolated from each other that while there were still a lot of hits that got big through grassroots support, mainly on TikTok, they all seemed more like just a way for people to kill time than actual memorable songs that people really cared about. And for the record, this isn't just me speculating, I've got the data to back it up. Billboard calculates its charts by giving every song a score based on how much they were listened to that week, and the number 3 song on the charts in November of 2020 had the same number of points as the number 17 song from 1 year earlier. So yeah, the general public statistically cared less about music in 2020 than they did at pretty much any point over the past few decades. The only song I really saw people rally behind in 2020 was WAP, and that was mostly because they wanted to stick it to Tucker Carlson and Ben Shapiro, which, granted, there are worse reasons to rally behind something, but it still says a lot about 2020 that the most talked about song of the year got that way out of spite. No one had the mental energy to be truly passionate about music in 2020, and because of that, the sense of populism and unity that the pop scene brought to the American people in 2019 quickly dissolved, only to be replaced by several other, much more nefarious forces. And what were those forces, you ask? Well, there's only one way to find out. In this video, I'll be counting down the first half of the top 10 worst hit songs of 2020 in my own personal opinion. A song is only eligible for this list if it's predicted to make Billboard magazine's year-end list of the 100 biggest songs of 2020. And so if you're wondering why a particular song wasn't on this list, the answer is that it wasn't one of the 100 biggest songs of the year according to Billboard. In other words, I did not decide which songs were eligible for this list, but I did decide which order to put them in based solely on my own completely personal opinion. Also, please keep in mind that the United States is a huge, incredibly diverse place, with hundreds of millions of different people, all with their own listening habits. Meaning that even if you don't personally recognize some of these songs, that doesn't mean that millions of people weren't buying, streaming, and listening to them. The world we live in today is more divided than ever, and no, pop music is by no means exempt from that fact. And with that, I think we're all set. Time to give this year the best non-flamethrower-related kick-in-the-ass goodbye I possibly can as we count down.
Had a lot of girls in my day, wanted more from me. But there's only really one way to start a family. And I know you can't believe it's true, but I'm man enough to say to you, I'm a virgin.
Okay, so before we start, let me make one thing clear. I'm aware that some of the entries on this list are going to come across as a bit nitpicky. Like I said, I have my issues with the way the public's general relationship to the pop scene evolved over the year, but as for the music itself, 2020 was one of the most consistently solid times for popular music I can remember. Most of the songs on this worst list aren't god-awful train wrecks with no redeeming qualities, and instead we've got a bunch of songs with really frustrating external factors that prevent me from enjoying them, and b, songs that are mostly passable or mediocre with one or two particular elements that really drag the whole thing down for me. So please keep in mind that I don't hate this first pick. In fact, I hardly even dislike it, but it still managed to squeak onto the list because, out of all the big hits from 2020, I don't think any of them had more wasted potential than this one.
Whoa!
I know it's typically a bad idea to lead with contentious picks on lists like this. You usually want something to ease people in and be generally agreeable before you start dishing out the hot takes. And trust me, I am aware that this song has a pretty good reputation, at least among the people I've talked to. So let me just say that, unlike every other song on this list, my distaste for Come and Go is coming out of a place of respect. Specifically, respect for Juice WRLD.
I still see your shadows in my room.
If you've been following my channel for a while, you'll know that I've gone on a journey with this dude, starting out thinking that he was just a whiny baby bro trying to take a bite out of that sweet, succulent Post Malone pie. Good lord, that's disgusting imagery. I'm truly sorry for that. But yeah, at first I thought he was just a wannabe, but then over time I did come to appreciate what he was about and what he was trying to do, culminating with me naming Robbery as one of my favorite songs of last year. I gained even further respect and sympathy for him after watching Rodrigo's video deconstructing his posthumous career, and while I won't lie and say I love all or even most of his music, he absolutely deserves to be recognized for all of his many accomplishments, and the few songs of his that I do enjoy really are something special. It's just a shame that Come and Go isn't one of those lucky few, because damn it, it could have been.
I try to be everything that I can, but sometimes I come out as being nothing.
I already did a full analysis of this song a couple months back, and I don't really have a ton more to add. When I did that analysis in my fall top 20 ranking, I said that this song was pretty decent. And if you catch me in the right mood, I might still say that, purely based on how excellent Jared is on here.
I'm always fucking up and wrecking shit. It seems like I perfected it. I offer you my love, I hope you take it like some medicine.
His performance is moody and dour without being crushingly unpleasant, and I really commend the use of thematic sound as the intensity of the melody drops back when he's unsure and down on himself, only to slowly build up again as he gives himself a pep talk about how this is going to be the time he finally gets a relationship right. So yeah, everything Juice WRLD does on this song is as good as I could possibly hope for. In fact, there's only one single thing in the entire song that he gets really, really wrong. And unfortunately, it just so happens to be the very first words out of his mouth. No, he really didn't.
Every day.
I don't think it's controversial to say that Marshmello is the biggest producer in the world right now, and I think it's only slightly less controversial to say that it isn't actually because he's good at making music, it's because he's a marketing genius. The dude behind the mask isn't even 30 years old, and yet he immediately burst onto the scene 5 years ago with an instantly iconic look and logo, countless brand and sponsorship deals, and perfect instincts of exactly where and when to promote himself to cement his dead, ballsack-looking eyes into the minds of children everywhere. Marshmello is currently the third most subscribed to musician on YouTube behind only Justin Bieber and Blackpink. And he's clearly a networking god on the level of DJ Khaled, an H-Bomber guy, and me, considering the sheer number and variety of artists he's been able to pull into his orbit. A collaboration with Marshmello is practically a rite of passage for any up-and-coming pop star at this point, and I personally like to think that these artists view it as a trial for themselves, because if you can collaborate with Mr. Christopher Comstock and not get eaten alive by his obnoxious, dirt-cheap, shoddy beatwork, then you are truly a legend, and like the man said, legends never die. And the worst part of all of this is that Marshmello is clearly capable of making good music. I still like Happier with Bastille, Be Kind by Halsey is a masterpiece, and even Come and Go shows that Marshmello is capable of adapting and giving artists the style and texture of production that they need to shine. The entire first minute of this song sounds incredible, and if he had kept up that style of production throughout the entire song, it would be a strong contender for the best list. But then...
Love don't always come and go.
Oh, okay then. So that's where the murder hornets went. See, I told you they'd come back. The second Marshmello retreats into that fuzzy, tinny, cheap-sounding radio static he uses for every single one of his drops, all my interest for this song is shot dead out of the sky. There are other problems I can point to in the song too, like how it ends a bit earlier than would feel natural and how wonky it is to have the second drop be weaker than the first, but the fundamental problem is that the entire song is an amazing build-up to a payoff that simply sounds bad, and unfortunately, that kinda ruins the whole thing for me. I respect it for its positive qualities, and there are songs that miss this list that I dislike listening to more than this one, but this song had pure gold right at its fingertips and let it all slip away. And frankly, that hurts enough to warrant a spot on this list. You know, these year-end rankings always end up doing great numbers for the channel and drawing in tons of new people, and I imagine that dumping on a song as beloved as Come and Go just pissed a lot of those new people off. If I were smart, I would probably follow that up by saying something more agreeable, and, you know, not by saying that there were 8 big songs this year that I hated more than Yummy by Justin Bieber, but, hey, what you gonna do?
Yeah, you got that yummy, 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 yummy.
Yes, remarkably, this song was, in fact, from 2020. In fact, it was released on January 3rd of 2020, the same day that the United States killed General Soleimani in a drone strike and brought us closer to war with Iran than we've ever come before. In a way, Yummy by Justin Bieber is sort of the perfect bad pop song for 2020, because neither the song nor the year had anything to hide. I mean, think about it. 2020 laid all its cards on the table immediately, not 3 days in and World War III was the top trend on Twitter. The tone of the year was set swiftly and efficiently. In a similar vein, you don't even have to wait 6 seconds into the lead single from Justin Bieber's 5th studio album before he's singing about how much he loves your yummy, yummy, yummy. He's got nothing to hide, and frankly, I appreciate the honesty.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, the yummy, yum, the yummy, yum.
Say that word. Yeah,
I bet a significant number of you watching haven't even heard any portion of this song besides the first 20 seconds, and frankly, you don't need to because that's all that matters. The rest of the song is a completely by-the-numbers pop song with not one single notable trait about it, lyrical or otherwise. The song is basically just a piece of store-brand white bread with one corner dipped in diet vitamin water. I mean, yeah, that one corner tastes like Kool-Aid mixed with pool water and feels disgusting and soggy in your mouth, and sure, you could just rip the corner off and eat the rest of the bread slice, but why on earth would you ever want to? Yummy is a marketing move, pure and simple. Bieber knew that the only way he was gonna get people to care about his boring-ass album was to do something gaudy and stupid, and so he slapped a gross chorus onto an objectively normal song and literally told his fans to stream it on loop while they sleep so that he could get a bunch of free press and headlines when Yummy by Justin Bieber debuted at number one, which it didn't, thank God. So if you guys are wondering why this song isn't any lower on the list, all I have to ask is, what would be the point? Every other song on this list, including Come and Go, is here because it tried to be something and, in my opinion, failed in one way or another. Whereas Yummy by Justin Bieber accomplished exactly what it set out to do. I mean, let's be real here. If you heard that there was a song called Yummy by Justin Bieber and you had any interest whatsoever in listening to it, the song probably gave you exactly what you were looking for. I'm not angry at Yummy for the same reason I don't get angry at YouTube comments that say, fuck you, you suck. I mean, you clearly don't respect me enough to even insult me properly, so why the hell would I waste any of my mental energy on you? Yummy by Justin Bieber doesn't piss me off. It makes me roll my eyes, close the tab, and never think about it again in my life, and frankly, that suits me fine. Now, if the country remix of Yummy was what charted, we would be having a very different conversation. Oh, what's that? You haven't heard of the remix of Yummy that Justin Bieber put out with Florida Georgia Line? Oh, okay. Well, here are the highlights.
Yo, JB. Talk to him one time.
Ain't on my side, you're number one. Yeah, every time I come around, you get her done.
Shout out, girl, I'm on the way. I've been up in Waffle House, but you my Chick-fil-A. We can call it home cooking. I'm your chicken, you my dumpling. I've been into Waffle Fries since our first day. Ain't got time for playing, I'ma clean your whole plate. Girl, I'ma lick it up.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why 10,000 Hours will not be making this list. Next.
Tryna act super tough, but inside I'm a 12-year-old boy.
Alright, it's official. I'm sick of Kane Brown.
I'm homesick. This feeling that I'm feeling, no, we don't quit.
The past few years have seen a steady rise in the relevance of country music on the charts, and a significant factor in that can be contributed to a subgenre that many are calling boyfriend country. I mean, sure, you still have your Luke Bryan, and your Luke Combs, and your Luke Bryce, and your Luke Graham, and of course you've got your world-conquering country superstars like Marshmello, and Justin Bieber, and Bebe Rexha, but if you're looking for the soul of country music over the past few years, you'll find it tenderly wrapped in the arms of humble, sweet-as-honey hometown boys ripe for taking home to mama. It's not like I don't get why this happened. I mean, when the default sound of country for half a decade is Blake Shelton bragging about not knowing how to do the Dougie and Florida Georgia Line ditching their girlfriends to go jerk off into a pile of dirt, it was inevitable that a backlash was coming. But while the change of pace was refreshing at first, it got old real fast, and now the tone of country music has slid back into the same pattern of saccharine mid-tempo ballads that dominated Southern airwaves throughout the entire Bush administration, resulting in smash hits for acts like Dan and Shay, Russell Dickerson, and of course, Mr. Kane Brown.
Everybody's talking about heaven like they just can't wait to go.
Kane Brown has always been a frustrating figure for me, with a deep, rich, and very likable voice that I'm very disappointed is never used for anything besides the most boring, cliched, overdone pop country love songs this side of Lone Star. And for the record, I think Kane Brown himself kind of agrees with me, considering that he's clearly been looking for a route out of Nashville and into the mainstream over the past year or so, doing several big-name pop collaborations, one of which gave him his second biggest hit. So who knows, maybe a future as a real pop star is in the cards for Brown, but as of now, he's still stuck pumping out Hallmark Channel schlock like Heaven, Good As You, and most recently, Homesick.
If home is where the heart is, I'm homesick for you.
But what's so bad about Homesick, you ask? It's just a song about how Kane Brown is missing his wife at home while he's out traveling. I mean, sure, it's corny, it's boring, and it's so wholesome it makes Mr. Rogers look like Logan Paul, but surely dullness alone can't make it worse than Yummy by Justin Bieber, right? What did this song do to get under your skin that much, Sean? Well, do you remember that one line in Thinking Out Loud by Ed Sheeran that everyone hates?
When my hair's all but gone and my memory fades, and the crowds don't remember my name.
You know, where he humble brags about how rich and famous he is in the middle of an unrelated love song. Yeah, imagine that one line, but worse and an entire verse long.
Well, it says Kane Brown on a sign with a line out the door. Sold out some little town I've never been before. Yeah, they're screaming my name.
Oh, well, would you look at that? My ramen's done. Just give me one second. I just want to dig into this. Oh, hope it's not too hot. Ow, 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 ow.
Yeah, they're screaming my name. This is what we dreamed about.
The second verse of Homesick by Kane Brown is one of the most bewildering swerves I've ever heard a song like this take, where he stops talking about how much he loves his wife and just starts bragging about how he's a hugely successful country star. And it's not just the one line like Thinking Out Loud. Oh no, he devotes a third of the song to doing this. I guess the idea was supposed to be that even with all the fame and the success, he's still not able to stop thinking about her, which, whatever, cute, I guess, but regardless of the intentions, why the hell did you have to phrase it like that? The first verse and the chorus are all about, what was it again?
All those little moments are every reason why I'm homesick.
Yeah, Little Moments. The song is supposed to be very intimate and personal and cutesy, and the absolute last thing that kind of atmosphere needs is a reminder that all these moments are being broadcast into the world and consumed by millions of people. This is like if in the middle of Hey There Delilah, the dude had started singing about how cool it was that he was the lead singer of the chart-topping multi-platinum rock band The Plain White Tees. Oddly enough, that's not really contributing to the vibe you're going for here. Honestly, I think the main sticking point of this song to me wasn't just the self-congratulation. Oh, no. It was the fact that he name-dropped himself.
Well, it says Kane Brown on a sign with a line out the door.
He literally opened the second verse of this love song to his wife by describing his name up in flashing lights on a billboard. In fact, you know who it kind of reminded me of?
Who gets this motherfucker started? God. Who took your bitch at the party? God. I took your bitch in the party. God.
Yeah. This is the level that Kane Brown is on, people, except somehow even worse than that, because at least Cardi was trying to make a song about herself. She didn't somehow miss the entire point of the type of music she was making. And the name drop also brings up another big question. How the hell are you supposed to cover this? I mean, as I understand it, the biggest market for boyfriend country is karaoke bars and dipshits strumming the guitar trying to get laid, so how the hell are you supposed to sing this song when it literally has Kane Brown's name opening the second verse? What effect is this supposed to achieve if anyone besides Kane Brown himself sings it? Hey girl, did you hear how Kane Brown sold out a concert in bumfuck nowhere, Missouri the other day?
Oh my god, take me!
This song sucks. It tried to be boring, and it wound up as clumsy and incompetent at best, and conceited at worst. I can think of zero practical uses for this besides being sung specifically by Kane Brown directly to his wife, and frankly, even that's kind of a stretch. Congratulations, Kane. Your Marshmello collaboration is no longer the most embarrassing thing you've ever done, and that is a rare feat that few others have matched. Alright, we still got two more songs to talk about, but first I want to give a quick but very important shout out to the people who made this video possible, my supporters on Patreon. My $5 patrons are scrolling up the screen as I speak, as well as my $10 supporters including Ann B, Bald Mark, Celeste Sucks, Flarbu, Fruit Goblin, Ghosty, Ginger Ace 08, It's Just Louise, Jins314, Leaf Bradshaw, Liam Coles, Liam Kinch, Luke Newman, Lukes99, Mike Duggar, Nick Cage, Plaguebearer, Prideful Zella, Razor Shark, Riley Glenn, Ryan Eister, Tim Shoop, Trivi, and Zach Riggs, and my $20 top supporters including Arnarok, Cat Boyerism, Eric Strebing, Fox Navarro, Hey Guys, Sean Fay, Wolf of Diamond X Studios here, and Jeffrey Berman, KFW, Lexa White,
Clan Bayard Push Gwingish, Go Get a Quinn Drobo, Clan Cecilio, Go Go Go,
Lizette Garcia, Maxi, Mike Graham 72, Natalie J, Nuclear Winter, Pierre Lou Lang, Roland Webster, Sil Merrill, That One Guy Who Hates Bohemian Rhapsody, The Music Guy in the Group, The Nocturne System, 999, Ultranatic Productions, and Watcher. I'll go into more detail about the Patreon rewards in part 2 of this video, but just know that these incredible people are the ones who made this video and everything within it possible. And truly, from the bottom of my heart, I cannot thank them enough. More on that later, though. For now, let's keep this list moving.
I see you looking in a strong way, but I won't give it up. Supermodels, they were all fake, 'cause I never humped.
I was not planning on putting this song on the list.
I hope she makes you smile the way you made me smile.
There are many interesting things to say about I Hope by Gabby Barrett, the biggest sleeper hit of 2020, which is still rising on Billboard as I write this, nearly a full year into its chart run. It's extremely rare in this age of viral marketing and races for number one debuts that we get a song that rises so slowly and has this much staying power. Just to put this into perspective, Pop Smoke hit the Hot 100 for the first time, released a mixtape, died, released another album posthumously, and became one of the biggest names in music with 4 hit songs, all while I Hope was slowly rising up the charts to where it is now. As far as the modern pop scene goes, I Hope truly is a wood furnace in the world of fireworks, and that alone is pretty admirable. There are also many things to say about Gabby Barrett, who is both the first alumni of American Idol and the first vocally conservative person to have a stable hit in a long time. A good year for pro-Trump women named Barrett, 2020 was. Now, I am not a fan of American Idol nor Donald Trump, so let me clarify that neither of those factors had anything to do with this song spot on the list, which means that I must hate the song for its sound and or lyrics, right? No. Not at all, really. I mean, I don't think it sounds great. Gabby Barrett sings like Hannah Montana with a head cold, and the production is a bit cheap and watered down for my taste, but it's serviceable at the very least. I'm also aware that Barrett's lyrics, where she rants and rages about how she hopes the asshole who cheated on her has to go through all the same shit he put her through, definitely struck a nerve with some people who found it to be too vindictive and or unpleasant, but eh. I think it works. Gabby said that she wasn't writing this about any actual person or experience. She was just writing something that no one would ever say out loud, but would still be cathartic to hear for people who are hurting, and I think it does that well. And so, if I've got all these good things to say about I Hope, then what is it doing on this list? Well...
like it did on me.
Yeah, babe, I hope he shows up in a 2 a.m. pic from a friend hanging on to a girl to just rub it in.
I think I'm the only one who thought that the Charlie Puth remix of I Hope was not dead on arrival. I mean, yeah, it is kind of funny that Charlie Puth spent 2 years publicly denouncing his first album of watered-down, easy-listening schlock, claiming that the label forced him into that sound and he was embarrassed to have ever gone along with it, only to immediately retreat back into that sound the instant his more mature stuff started to see diminish returns. But even with that being said, Charlie's performance on this remix really doesn't bother me all that much.
I hope you both feel the sparks by the end of the drive. I hope you know he's the one by the end of the night.
Granted, he does kind of sound like Justin Bieber trying to go Super Saiyan, and it's kind of awkward and cheap sounding, but it's awkward and cheap sounding the same way the rest of the song is awkward and cheap sounding, so at the very least there's some audio cohesion going on there. Unfortunately, that's the only thing about this remix that's even remotely cohesive. I'll cut to the chase here. By turning I Hope into a duet, Charlie Puth has completely thrown off the balance of the song and transformed it from a straightforward revenge fantasy into a weird, unfocused mess that really doesn't serve any purpose. In the original, you had one verse of Gabby saying she hopes her ex finds a great girl who then cheats on him, and then a second verse where she hopes that he gives her a second chance only to have her cheat again. Very basic, very simple, and exactly the kind of thing I could imagine a vengeful, heartbroken listener would want to hear. Now, if you approach this remix by considering how the dynamic would be affected by adding in a male vocalist, you know, like an artist would, then maybe you would have Charlie play the role of the cheater, or maybe he would be a friend talking to her, or something like that. Instead, they literally just have Charlie butt in at the halfway point and sing the second half of the song with the gender swapped and no other changes. So now, instead of having the song be one person playing out a revenge fantasy, you now have two people with no narrative connection to each other playing out two different halves of the same fantasy. No consideration is given to how turning I Hope into a duet would affect the song as an artistic statement. All it does is take a cohesive song and bog it down with unnecessary questions about why this story is split between two people. Who is Charlie Puth's character? Why is he on the song? What relation do he and his situation have to Barrett in her verse? None of these questions are addressed because the label assumed the consumer wouldn't bother to ask. And frankly, I find that to be kind of insulting as a listener. Even with all that being said, though, I was still hesitant to put the remix on the list. I mean, sure, they basically all but stated that having a famous name on the song to make it more profitable was more important to them than having the song make sense, but at least the solid structure of the song was still intact. I mean, if you just ignore the fact that two people are singing, or you imagine that two people are singing about the same scenario they both just happened to be in, then it still kind of works, right? That is what I thought. Until I realized that Charlie actually made one other change to his part besides just swapping the pronouns. You see, in the original, Gabby's pre-chorus goes like this.
I hope she comes alive and rents every one of your plans. I hope we spend your last dime to put a rock on her hand.
Now that makes sense. She's hoping her ex loves his new fling enough to buy her a diamond ring, only for her to stab him in the back, robbing him of both his heart and his money. This is what Charlie says.
I hope he comes along and wrecks every one of your plans. I hope he spends his last time to put a rock on your head.
And just like that, I know that Charlie Puth doesn't care about this song even the tiniest bit. The entire point of Charlie's verse is supposed to be that he hopes she gets hurt because she gets cheated on. So why the hell does Charlie say that he wants her new man, who, I reiterate, is cheating on her, to spend his last dime on her? He's literally saying, yeah, your boyfriend is gonna spend all his money and literally go broke to dress you up in diamonds, and then he's gonna cheat on you. Sucks to be you, huh? I mean, yeah, getting cheated on really sucks, but at least you get to keep the diamonds.
I hope he spends his last time to put a rock on your head.
Unlike Gabby's part, where the guy bankrupting himself to buy a diamond was symbolic of how much he's giving up for her just to have it all ripped away, Charlie's part wound up the way it did because the label told him to gender swap Barrett's second verse, he went through the motions like a middle schooler writing a history essay, he realized that buying diamond rings for their partner is more of a guy thing, and so he rewrote that lyric, and in doing so, completely missed the entire point of what it was trying to convey. It's so soulless, you think it had been done by algorithm. I know it might come across as ridiculously nitpicky to harp on about this one line so much, but to me, the Charlie Puth remix of I Hope is a representation of everything wrong with the way the music industry uses remixes to promote songs. Seeing them as just a way of boosting sales by slapping more star power onto an established song with no thought given to how the presence of this new person changes the identity of the piece. The I Hope remix is a perfect example of capitalism and greed corrupting art, and even if you don't like the original song, well, I hope that we can all agree that it at least deserved better than this.
Underneath the lies and the big talk, I've been waiting for a wave. I never watched porn, never did drugs, 'cause I'm terrified.
You know, of all the people I was planning to discuss more than once on this list, Charlie Puth was not among them, and yet, here we are, so, hey, remember this shit?
We don't talk anymore. Talk anymore.
You know, We Don't Talk Anymore by Charlie Puth and Selena Gomez, generally agreed to be one of the lamest, hokiest, and most pointless love songs of all time. I mean, I personally don't hate it, but that's purely down to aesthetic reasons. It's a guilty pleasure if there ever was one, and it's very clearly and obviously a laughably bad song. So, did somebody order a pandemic-themed rewrite of it? No? Well, you got one.
But if the world was ending, you'd come over, right? You'd come over and you'd stay the night. Would you love me for the hell of it?
Okay, so before anyone says anything, I know this song wasn't released specifically to capitalize on the pandemic. It came out in late 2019 and just had the good fortune to hit radio at the best possible moment. Or, you know, the worst possible moment, depending on how you look at it. I mean, come on, do you really think that any artists would be tactless enough to intentionally put out a specifically pandemic-themed love song while hundreds of thousands of innocent people are dying on the streets? God, that'd be really insulting. Good thing I don't have to talk about one of those. But yeah, it was very tempting to view this song entirely through pandemic-themed lenses, which would arguably be fair, since there's no way that If the World Was Ending would have caught on if the world were not, in fact, actually ending. You know, unless you think they would have been able to ride the hype train of the Issues Girl into the stars. However, all you really need to know is that this song blows just as a normal piece of music, and the context of when it came out certainly didn't help it at all. So, while I can't imagine that hearing this song everywhere definitely could have made some people's lockdowns even more insufferable, that wasn't their intentions, and it didn't affect me that way personally, but the fact that If the World Was Ending is a melodramatic piece of crappy teenage diary poetry that makes me cringe with secondhand embarrassment whenever I hear it, that is completely on the table, so let's cut it open and dissect it, shall we?
It's been a year now, think I figured out how to let you go and let communication die out.
I'm not gonna lie, I thought we had gotten past this type of song on the pop charts. You know, the spare, moody, dull as dirt, whispery whine fests from the likes of James Bay and Nash. It's become increasingly obvious that no one actually enjoys or cares about these songs, and they're literally only being kept alive because iHeartRadio needs something to play in between pretending Lil Baby doesn't exist and pretending Pop Smoke doesn't exist. If the World Was Ending was the biggest of these types of songs in a while purely because circumstances aligned so heavily in its favor, but I don't think it's gonna lead to a big dirge revival or anything like that. First of all, the song is led by one J.P. Sachs, whose name sounds like the name of a bank, and whose voice sounds like what would happen if a bank learned to sing.
I know, we know, you weren't down for forever, and it's fine.
If this dude were any whiter, he'd make Mike Pence's hair look like 6'9"s by comparison. He's the stock photo that came with the frame in audio form, just a talentless, banal, completely unnoteworthy, sad, corny fuck. Incidentally, Sad Corny Fuck was, in fact, the name of his follow-up single. 'Cause, you know, he's witty and self-aware like that. Apparently, Julia Michaels reached out to him for a collaboration after she listened to his LP and got inspired by it, which, yeah, sounds about right. So what did these two whiny, boring people make when they put their heads together? Well, they made If I Die Young by the band Perry.
If I die young, bury me in satin, lay me down on a bed of roses.
Yeah, you guys remember this one, right? That Taylor Swift knockoff from 2010 where a girl fantasizes about being dead and how much everyone's gonna miss her and how everyone's gonna recognize how profound and meaningful all her thoughts are after her life gets cut short?
Maybe then you'll hear the words I've been singing. Funny when you're dead, how people start listening.
Yeah, it's basically just that, but a duet.
Would you love me for the hell of it? All our fears would be irrelevant. If the world was ending, you'd come over right.
I mean, that's basically the entire idea behind the song. These two people fantasize about the entire world coming to an end just so they won't have to worry about the future. And they can stay in their shallow little puppy love bubble forever without ever having to deal with any real consequences. And of course, just like in We Don't Talk Anymore, the couple may have broken up on bad terms, but naturally they're both still yearning for each other, and rather than using the concept of a duet to explore different viewpoints or have any sort of interplay, you know, like an artist would, you just have two people describing the exact same experience. I mean, for God's sake, even when the world ends in the actual song, they barely even notice it.
I was distracted and in traffic. I didn't feel it when the earthquake happened.
It didn't scare me when the earthquake happened.
I have no idea who this song is for or what it's trying to convey. There are tons of songs out there about living in the moment and making the most of your life without worrying about the consequences of tomorrow, and I love a ton of those songs, but that's because they help you get caught up in the rush of the moment. They make you feel alive. They make you want to grab that diem and carpe the ever-living fuck out of it. This song doesn't make me feel alive. It deadens me. This song is for someone who can't accept that life is tough and the real world has consequences, and so they choose to wallow in misery and wish for everything to come crashing down around them and make all the tough decisions for them. I want to die so people will finally pay attention to my brilliant thoughts. I want the world to end because, hey, it can't be that hard to be happy for the rest of your life if that life and everything else is gonna end soon anyways. I don't usually like to use this term, but I'm sorry, it really is emo in the cringiest, most juvenile, most self-centered way. And I've got no idea how anyone could possibly get anything out of this. Bottom line, if you want to fantasize about a world where your actions have no consequences, at least do yourself a favor and have some fun with it. And you know what? I said I wasn't gonna bring it up, but I'm sorry. It fucking sucks that this was the theme song of the pandemic. 2020 has been one of the most uniquely awful years in the modern history of the human race. And when our kids look back at the media we turn to help us through this unspeakably miserable moment in history, I don't want them to see us burying our heads in the sand and giving in to our depression and misery. I want our kids to know that the state of the world isn't breaking us, it's enraging us. We need to tell future generations that what we were forced to endure in 2020 isn't causing us to plug our ears and turn our backs on the harsh reality of our neighbors crying out in pain, but rather waking us up, mobilizing us, and motivating us to take control of our lives to prove that no, we are not going to lie down, we are not going to accept this, and we are going to do everything in our power to build the world back up from the rock bottom we're currently suffering through. And so to end this video, we're not going to back down. We're gonna take a stand, and we are going to tell this human centipede of a year, once and for all, exactly what we think about it.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck this godforsaken year and everything about it.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
2020 could eat my British ass raw with a side of soggy ass Travis Scott chips.
Fuck you, 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
2020 falls well below any standards of decency.
Fuck 2020. All my homies hate 2020.
Fuck 2020! Fuck you if you lived in it!
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020!
Yeah, this year sucked or something.
I was going to see my favorite band, Silver Sun Pickups, live this year, but that didn't happen because fuck 2020.
I don't usually swear, so I'm gonna let another Matt say it for me.
Fuck 2020!
Thanks, Black Bear.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
About to pour bleach in my eyes because I don't need 2020 vision.
2020 took the expression, what's the worst that could happen, as a challenge. Piss off.
2020, I did not enjoy it.
Hey, 2020, are you Black Bear? Because fuck you.
6ix9ine came back and we got a good MGK album. Please let this nightmare end.
Yeah. Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020.
That this has been a pretty bad year for pretty much everyone who is in Jeff Bezos, so yeah, fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020, this downward spiral of a year.
2020 is bad.
That is all.
Throw 2020 away! Ow! Just throw it in the trash! Ow!
Ooh. Ooh, fuck you, 2020. Ooh.
This crazy year of 2020 that has just been... totally screwy.
Rock shows and was, you know, amongst the people, and that was all taken away from us.
Now, 2020's been... I'm trying to think of a nice way to say it. Fucked up!
Fuck 2020! Shit sucks! Get it out of here! Throw it out with the trash!
Fuck 2020! It's the opposite of finding money!
Call one of those trash trucks that cost $1 million. Why does it cost so much to haul away trash?
Nothing about it is funny! Fuck 2020! Fuck you, 2020.
Screw 2020.
Fuck this year. Fuck 2020.
Screw 2020.
Fuck 2020. For real, shit made crazy.
Fuck 2020. You know what I'm saying?
Screw 2020.
If 2020 were a mixed drink, I think it would go something like this. Fuck 2020.
Fuck 2020. It's a fucked up year for everybody, man. This shit is crazy.
Fuck 2020, dude. Fuck 2020, all right? Why? We got pandemics, we got killer fucking hornets, we got fucking riots, we got fucking crazy presidents, we got all types of fucking shit.
Fuck 2020, for anybody that has been negatively affected by the events of this year. Good comes with the bad comes with the good, but we gonna make it through.
It's such a strange time for everyone. Nothing. We don't even know what normal is anymore.
You know, 2020, when I said school's out forever, I didn't actually want that to happen.
So many lives that have been lost to this pandemic.
Worst things about 2020. Okay, first of all, would have to be the virus, man. And running a close second to that is your president.
People spoke out this year, and they might have said something that you might not have expected them to say. You're like, oh, that's how you really feel?
You can't allow what's going on around you to stop you from getting where you're supposed to be.
Things bad happen to you, but you can't fear it. You can't fear the road that you choose to walk down.
We get tested so we can have a testimony. So stay strong through these difficult times. Peace and blessings to you and your family.
I'm Sean Fay Wolf of Diamond X Studios, and from the bottom of my heart, fuck 2020. See y'all in part two.
What up, it's your boy Big Snoop, D-O-double-G, giving a shout out to my dog, the one and only, Sean. You understand me? Shiny Sean. Sean Fay Wolf.
I'm Ego Raptor, and I say subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music.
I need everybody looking at this right now to do me a favor. Subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music. I don't usually do that, but I'm going to do it because he's a studio rat like your boy. He gets in here and he gets his work in.
Quick shout out to my man, Sean Fay Wolf.
I just want to give a big shout out to Sean Fay Wolf.
Subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music. Y'all know what it is. Let's get it.
This motherfucker knows music, baby. You want to talk about Sean Fay Wolf? Forget it. This fucker knows music. He's got all kinds of tunes in his ears.
I want to give a shout out to my main man, Sean Fay Wolf.
Ow!
Sorry, that howl was probably unnecessary, but it's too late now. We went down that road.
You know what I'm saying? I got to say what's up. Yeah, to my homies over there at Diamond Axe Studios, man. Yeah, man. Hey, y'all go over there and follow Diamond Axe Studios, man.
Hey, Sean Fay Wolf, it's Rebecca Black.
Hey, Sean. This is Smokey Robinson, man.
Okay, my man, Sean Fay Wolf.
Hi, Sean. It's Richard Marks. Being 2020, anything could happen. In fact, I had a vision that you actually did become a wolf. It's going to be a full moon. Be very careful.
Diamond Axe Studios Music. I want to say peace and love. And everybody out there, don't forget to check them out. Diamond Axe Studios Music.
Shout out to Diamond Axe Studio Music. And make sure y'all subscribe.
Shout out to Diamond Axe Studios Music. I want everybody right now to go subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music.
Quick shout out to Sean Fay Wolf.
I just want to give a big shout out to Sean Fay Wolf.
You know, Sean Fay Wolf, respect. And I just appreciate the fact that you even reached out to me.
I just want to give a big shout out and say subscribe to the Diamond Axe Studios Music.
You should also subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music.
Subscribe to Diamond Axe Studios Music.
Sean Fay Wolf, what's going on, homie?
Big shout out to Sean Faye Wolf.
I want to give a big, super duper extra special shout out to Sean Faye Wolf.
Yo, Sean! Sean Faye Wolf, goddammit! What the fuck is up? Number one, big ups to you, Sean. Booyah, kabooyah, boop, kabooyah, Sean. Shout out to Sean. Big shout out to Sean.
So go check it out. Diamond Axe Studios Music on YouTube. Mwah! Subscribe! All right, sweet.